Good news, everybody. I'm here with Daria, and we're going to be talking today about observability and monitoring, and I hope you'll join us on this episode of the Azure Enablement Show. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show. We will be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we're going to be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So I'm going to go follow up on Cornell's recommendation to talk to an expert on observability. But I think it would be better if I did that in customer mode. So let me switch to that right now. Okay, better. Now I'm in customer mode. Okay, so I think it's time to go talk to Daria. Hey, Daria.
Hi, David.
Hi, I was wondering if you could help me with stuff that's going on at work. Let me just lay it out for you. So one of the problems that I was talking to Kunal about was our situation around our monitoring and our observability is terrible. And by terrible, I mean, I don't think I have a good idea what's working, what's not working, what's running. And not only that, I'm getting paged all the time, and like in the mornings, at night, late at night, stuff like that. And it's just terrible. Can you help me understand like what I need to do to start thinking about doing this right?
Of course, David. Frequently, when we think about observability, we think about collecting many metrics, have logs for everything, and have a lot of traces. But that's not enough. Because as we evolve and build more services in different modes, for example, we are now in microservices world, the concept of how we approach observability is morphing into what problems we want to solve, what questions we want to have answered. And we frequently do a lot of mistakes which are common across different engineers. For example, we over-instrument. We have so much data and we don't really know what to do with it. Or we have too many dashboards. I knew teams who have 200 dashboards. And when problem happens, they start looking, what dashboard should we look at now? Which one will answer our questions? And also there is a lot of tribal knowledge and very common, not enough documentation and a lot of knowledge which is inside people's head. So that's common things. So where would you start, David? I would recommend you.
So I want to say that the reason why I was smiling is that it all sounds exactly like our setup. It sounds like, I mean, like we've tried to do the thing where you monitor all the things. And so we've done that and we got monitors, you know, like, well, I mean, let's talk about where we're monitoring here. I mean, I think I'm doing the right thing. I'm monitoring all our components. Right. If there's a problem with CPU, I know about it instantly. If our disks fill up, isn't the right thing to monitor all the things?
Well, it depends, David. Of course, monitoring everything could be a solution, but you first need to understand that you are monitoring the right thing. And where I would start is to understand how your users are using your services. What matters to them? So you actually can answer a question about what's their experience in using your service and not about how many CPUs are experiencing high CPU every day. Because if your service is architected in a way that it fails over when specific component is not functioning, your customer experience will be great and you don't even need to alert your team in the middle of the night. You can just deal with it as a problem that you just solve when the time comes. And so I would always start with questions. What are different scenarios that your customers care about when they use your service? And also, I wouldn't postpone instrumentation of your service until it's already in production. I would start doing it when you are building your services, because this is the right time to think about what are different modalities and end-to-end journeys of service usage. Think about those user scenarios, but also think about your dependencies. If you are building your service depending on not reliable services, this will cause you a lot of problems. So make sure that you instrument to measure your dependencies reliabilities and not just measuring your service reliability, because frequently we depend on different components and different services. So does it help?
Yeah, so that helps. So I just want to figure out the dependency thing. You're saying that it's important not for me to just measure my own component stuff like that, and measure. Obviously, I have to measure from user scenarios, but I also should be paying attention to the things I depend on and monitoring those as well, right?
Absolutely, yes. Because if you just monitor your service and you know that your service is performing absolutely well, but your dependencies are down and your customers are calling you and saying, your service is not working. You look at your metrics and say, no, everything totally fine. But your key dependencies are down. So you obviously need to monitor for those. And you need to make sure that you also architect your service in a way that those dependencies don't impact your customer experience. So if one of your dependencies is down, you need to make sure that you have a good failover strategy.
Okay, so Daria, I have another question. It seems like there's different kinds of data I could be collecting. Like, what should I be, what kind of things should I collect and what are they good for?
Before you think of kind of data you will be collecting, think about different usages. For example, you will need to have alerting in place. You need to assure that you are collecting fast signals about your service health and that you're alerting on customer experience and not on underlying components that may not even reflect in customer experience. And it's just a temporary glitch, which is not impacting anything. So you would need to think about your alerting scenarios because you want to know about your problems fast. Then you also will need to collect metrics, logs, and traces to troubleshoot issues. When you received an alert and you know something is going wrong, you need to then troubleshoot to answer questions. What exactly is going wrong? In what stage of multi-step customer experience you have a problem? And this is where logs and traces will help you, obviously, and metrics as well. Also, you will not only interact with your metrics and dashboards and logs when problems happen. You would also use them for proactive problem detection. So you may just look for patterns and look, slice and dice your data by region, by service version, by component, by subscription. You will be looking for patterns in your collected metrics, logs, and traces, trying to understand, is there any problems? Is there anything you can optimize and make better? Is there any problems that you would detect by looking at this data? So think about those three scenarios. We talk about alerts, which need to be fast, and alert on what matters. You talk about troubleshooting, which also need to be fast and need to point you to the problem. And you need to do proactive problem management to understand where you can optimize your service.
Okay, so I get that. And I understand from what you just said where metrics and logs come into play. Where do traces come into play, really?
Well, they also come into play during troubleshooting and also during problem management because you need to understand how your service is processing a multi-step journey. And this is where traces are extremely valuable because you can look at every step and you can understand one specific user experience end-to-end, and traces are great in that.
Okay, great. So I have one last question for you. So given my situation, I understand the user scenario part, and I understand what this is about. Where should I start? Like, where do I start getting myself out of this the hole we've dug ourselves in with monitoring the wrong things?
Well, I would start by going and talk to your customers, understand what matters to them, what identify top journeys or customer scenarios of what matters to your customers. Does it matter to them that your service is fast, that it's successful? It may not matter that your service is fast if your customer is processing transactions, which shouldn't be real time. It just matters that they process at some stage of the day. In this case, latency probably wouldn't matter to you. Or if you are processing this transaction, but your customer need to have guarantee that it will be successful, then you will just monitor what matters to the customer. You will monitor success rate, you will implement retry logic and make sure that transaction processes in the end and latency wouldn't matter. But at the same time, if your customer is running a service that is all about speed, it's need to be very fast, then obviously you will not only care about success rate, but you will also care about latency. So talk to your customer, understand what dimensions of reliability which matters to them and what are those scenarios. And then you will look at your service. Obviously, don't switch off all your existing monitoring because you need to have visibility into your service health. But start instrumenting those scenarios that customers indicated as critical for them. And slowly, you will be able to change your alerting strategy to the new one, which will alert on customer experience.
Okay, that's super helpful. And I think I got a lot of work to go do. So I think I want to thank you. Let me switch back to host mode. Okay, back to host mode. So I want to thank you, Daria, and I'd like to thank everybody for watching this. I think that I learned a lot of stuff, and Daria gave me some good URLs for people to go look at to start reading about this, and I hope you'll do that. So I just want to thank everybody for joining us, and I hope you'll join us for more episodes of the Azure Enablement Show.